Right. Good evening, everyone. We are back again here with the Happiness Hour on Cobalt Blue Foundation. And I had a terrible sleep last night. And I just kept rolling in my bed. And all these thoughts were running through my head. And I was just thinking that what to do? I mean, how do I put myself to sleep? So I tried to put myself to sleep, but then within 15 minutes, I was again very restless and I could not sleep. So I woke up, I went to the washroom, I washed my face. I tried to do some deep breathing, but I still could not sleep. I'm sure a lot of you people must be going through these kind of sleepless nights, and specifically in these times when we are all in the lockdown, and somehow consciously or subconsciously or unconsciously, these things are beginning to affect our mind in manners that we don't understand. So tonight on the show, we have somebody who does understand how our mind behaves when we cannot go to sleep and what are the reasons behind it. And more important than that is, what is sleep? Who invented sleep? Why do we need to sleep? And what happens in our body when we are in the sleep, and how many cycles of sleep are there? Then we are going to talk about the issues of the sleep. If you can't go to sleep, what to do? And these tips and many more such interesting conversation that we will be having tonight with Dr. Manveer Bhatia. She is, we call her the sleep doctor, but she is a neurologist and she works in the areas of sleep and sleep disorders. So tonight we will be having very interesting conversation with her on the show, The Happiness Hour. So I'm gonna get Dr. Manveer online just in about 2 minutes time, and before that, I just want to ask all of you, if you have any questions that you want to ask the doctor, you can do that live. If you want to come on the show on a video, send me a request. I'll pull you up on the show and you can ask the question live on the video as well for the other audience to hear. But you can also write in the comment section there, and Dr. Manveer will try to answer some questions. It's going to be an interactive show, so she will be talking to you and asking you certain questions that will help you understand the concept of sleep in our lives. Okay, so I'm just gonna get Dr. Manveer on the show. Okay, so we are here, and our sleep doctor is just going to be with us any moment now. All right, so
Please do interact, write your comments, ask your questions, and let us know what you think of these concepts of sleep when Dr. Manveer comes online, and we are going to have her on the show. Okay, Dr. Manveer, you have to turn your,
phone
horizontally so we can see you better. All right,
is it okay?
Wonderful. And hey, yes. Can you hear my voice? Is it clear?
Yeah, I can hear you. Can you hear me also?
Yes, yes, I can hear you very much. Good evening, Dr. Manveer.
Good evening, and hopefully a good night ahead for everybody.
Yes, exactly. All right, so everyone, just a sound check. Just let us know if the sound is clear from my side and from Dr. Manveer's side as well. And if there's any issue, just do write in the comment section so that you have a better experience of tonight's conversation with Dr. Manveer. And I am going to welcome her on the show once again and with a round of applause by my studio audience. All right. Okay. So here we are. Okay, Dr. Manvi, your face is cut
it's
in
coming.
The thing.
So yeah, okay.
Turn your phone.
Okay. Yeah. A little bit. Is that okay?
Little better. You can come, or you can turn the phone. Yeah. This would be a little bit. Yes, that's better.
Okay.
Is that okay for you? Comfortable? All right.
Yeah, it's okay.
Okay. So, everyone, welcome to the Happiness Hour with me, Sandeep Verma, your host tonight. And we have with us Dr. Manvi, who will be talking about sleep. What is sleep and sleep related issues? And she will be giving us some tips about how to get better sleep, specifically in these times when we are going through this quarantine, and it might be bogging us down. A lot of you people must be experiencing some sort of a sleep issues. For me, yes, I do have sleep issues at time. I try, and strangely, I'm now trying to wake up early in the morning, and I'm having more issues in my cognition in the day than when I used to wake up much later.
Dhiraj, you're also in the camera.
In the day, so the age old saying that early bird gets the prize and you should wake up on time. How does that work? And is that a myth or is that a reality? And also, we'll be talking about the 8-hour myth that people say that we must sleep for 8 hours. All that things. And if you have any questions or any comment, do interact in the comment section and we will pull it up on the screen, and Dr. Manvi will be reading the comments and she will be reacting to them and talking about all that stuff. Okay, Dr. Manvi, perfect job. Your camera is perfectly set now.
It's okay.
Thank
yes,
you.
All right.
Thank you to your producers and your studio,
yeah.
studio
yes,
guys.
Studio
you know,
assistants.
Did a good job. All right.
Yeah.
Okay. So, welcome to the show once again. And I wanted to quickly ask you, how many hours did you sleep last night?
So I have always needed a little more sleep than usual. So if we talk about the duration of sleep, as an average adult, people need anywhere between 7, 7.5, 8, 8.5 hours.
Okay.
And usually, I need about 8 hours to feel very fresh, bright, alert.
Right.
But somehow, in the last 2 weeks, my requirement has become less, which I have tried all my life. So it's become about seven. So I have anyway one extra hour in the morning, which I can listen to the birds and do some walking and yoga. So that's helped.
That's a wonderful thing. And congratulations on the success of of being able to achieve that stuff, you know, that's a great job done. Tell me something, before we start the topic tonight, just wanted to know about you a little bit. How did you choose this line? How did you get into becoming the sleep doctor?
So I'm actually a trained neurologist. My career neurology training was at the All India Institute of Medical Sciences, New Delhi. After finishing my training, I was in charge of something called as epilepsies and looking at people at night, etc.
Right.
So to simple put it, that I could not understand what was happening at night in these patients.
Right.
So it was not epilepsy, it was something else. So I said, okay, let's try and go deeper. Sleep medicine around that time, about 25 years ago, was very much in its infancy in our country. So I went to US and I spent a lot of time at the Harvard University, tried to understand sleep. But I can tell you from that point till now, it's a journey which is very interesting. Mm. Every day I almost see a case which is a new, bright, new thing for me. And I have to still read a lot. And I think it's partly because the brain and the sleep, the issues are still not sorted out. We can't understand so many things. So it's a process of continuous learning. So that's how the journey has evolved.
Hmm. And the brain is a very, very, very complex place.
Very complex.
We have yet to understand a lot of things about
it. Yet to understand. So we have some technology now, lots of technology in which we can understand something about the brain. That's why sleep has become a new thing in the last, 40, 50 years. It's changed considerably. The knowledge of sleep, let's say. Not sleep is not new, but knowledge of sleep.
All right. And Dr. Bhatia, you have your first compliment. Nikki Aggie says, Dr. Bhatia, you are a legend. That's wonderful. All right. So
and I can
it's
see
nice,
a lot of people have joined from all over. Thank you so much, everybody, for being with us tonight.
Yes. And welcome to the Happiness Hour, guys. Please do write your comments and your questions and anything else that you want to discuss about sleep. And the sleep concept, or if you want to say something to Dr. Manveer Bhatia, do write
Hi,
in the
Regina.
Comment section. We put it up. All right. Okay. And yes, Mr. Dr. Bhatia, you can keep saying, acknowledging some of these people that you might know very well. I think they are.
So I have some of my medical graduates from which we have spent early part of our life. We have some friends, and they are people from all over the world. So I think your other question was the morning larks versus the evening owls.
So yes, my question was, I wanted to connect it to your answer, the first question that you said that you were able to successfully reduce 1 hour of your sleep time and got one extra hour in your morning. And then there was Nikki only, she said that why my requirement has increased and her sleeping hours have increased instead of decreasing, and which means her daylight has gone less. Why does that happen? Would you like to shed some light on that?
Yeah, it's, I just, before we go a little deeper, I want to say that sleep is a very individual and a very unique requirement.
Right.
So we have to understand that, like, each one of us has a different taste.
Right.
Somebody likes a lot more spice, somebody doesn't like spice. Somebody likes vegetarian, somebody doesn't like non-vegetarian. Some clothes choices are different, colors are different. So sleep is like that.
Right.
We all tend to think that everybody should be uniform. Mm. So we are all genetically unique. And I would say, we have to go a lot deeper to understand why has the need increased. Maybe there was a deficit over many days. And now, because there's a freedom to sleep, so you are getting what you really require.
Right.
Each one needs to figure out something called as a sleep need.
Right. Absolutely. And everybody has their own needs, like any other need. Sleep
need
is also also depends on your personality, your past, your habits and all that. And we'll go deeper
and
into the subject over
day?
A period of time. Go ahead, Dr. Manveer.
So the other thing was about people who tend to sleep late, and that has become pretty much routine. I have started seeing I used to see earlier teenagers, then there are 20s, 30s, 40s. Now I see even elderly. Everybody is pushed the time. And in fact, they say the discovery of light added to this, and then the discovery of the net.
Mm.
And now
Very
we have all sorts of things. So
I have a perfect picture for that.
So the day
what happens
and night,
every night.
This is what's happening at night. So I think people should start, we should ask them to write, what is the last activity they do before bedtime?
Okay.
So that will give some insight as to why the sleep time has got pushed. What is it that they do last at night before they go to sleep?
Right.
Or before
they're
putting the... Yeah, so that will make one understand. But
okay, so everybody in the who's watching the show, do write what is the last activity that you guys do before you go to sleep, so that we can have some discussion and some insight live while you guys are watching this show. All right, Dr. Manveer, please go ahead.
So we call this phenomena or this thing called as a delayed sleep phase, meaning that our body is being programmed to sleep ideally when the lights go off.
Right.
Oh, somebody said, I read. That's a very good thing. But read where? I mean, read is print media or screen is it also another thing nowadays.
Oh, that also matters, huh?
That also matters. See, because the screen produces a light which will suppress your hormone which tells you to sleep.
Oh, okay.
So people say that you know, I am on the screen because I can't sleep. Hmm. But we say the longer you stay on the screen, the sleep will keep getting pushed.
Oh, it's a vicious cycle then, huh?
Yeah. So somebody says on a paperback, somebody says I am reading, listening to music. So preferably decrease screen time.
What about people who are scrolling on social media or stuff like that, who are watching Instagram and all that in the night?
So then again, then they have to accept that their sleep will be delayed.
Okay, okay. It's the same and effect. Should, the brain gets confused. That is, it's the daytime. Yeah.
So you are stimulating the brain.
Okay, okay, okay.
You know, so that's what's going on.
So this brings me to my first first tip of the evening is that what could be an ideal activity, and not ideal because it's different for different people, but the one of the best activity to do before going to sleep?
So to get really a good quality sleep, we will talk about a little bit about the three dimensions of sleep. You need something like a relaxing activity. Oh, somebody's saying they practice relaxation techniques. Maybe they can hi Bholi. So they should practice some form of relaxation. We need the brain to disconnect. We need the wired brain to relax. Now, whatever works for you. Relaxation is again unique. For somebody, it may be some kind of music. For somebody, it may be just a shavasana. Somebody may want to do a child pose. Whatever you feel like doing, something to relax you.
Is it like that you should use your eyes less before you go to sleep? Is there a concept like that?
No, eyes not really. I'm not sure, but you should not be focusing on anything too much. So even if your eyes are closed, but if your brain goes into that, we call it a racing mind.
Right.
So that racing, if the thoughts will keep coming, that's also disturbing. So you need to somehow kind of block the thoughts.
Combination of that. Somebody said that, so there are a lot of comments coming and I just want to read something for you. Somebody said, how about reading on Kindle? Anu Bajaj is asking that.
Yeah, so Kindle has, I think they claim that they have this, and even some iPhones have claimed that they have changed the light
night
spectrum.
Mode.
And if you go more into the night mode, if the light brightness is a little less. But just want to tell everybody that there is this hormone which is secreted in our body towards the evening. It peaks at night. It's called melatonin. So that runs the whole orchestra in the body. And we can suppress it with caffeine and with the light. So I would try and say that let's stick to do some other things, like preferably, again, print media.
All right. So there's a clear answer that Kindle does interfere with your sleep.
Yeah, so preferably, print is the best, yeah.
All right. We have another question that says that, one second, I'm going to read.
Reading a book is good. Somebody's saying, is it bad to read a paperback book? No, the book is good. Some people now have gone into the little bit more depth about it. Should you read self-improvement books? Should you read again, anything which is stimulating should be avoided. I watched a Netflix show the other day, which was bad. Those are particularly bad. If you watch those very stimulating shows, you will definitely not get a good quality.
Yes, binge watching. Yes.
Binge watching is pretty bad.
So guys, Netflix, Kindle, and obviously you are going to watch Netflix on a screen. Remember that. So
on a bigger screen,
understand the concept. It is not the content is also there, but it's the light that is one part, which is stimulating your mind. The combination, the cocktail of the two, is worse form of exposure to give yourself before you go to sleep. Okay, and somebody saying that, but if I'm reading a book also, I have to keep my lights on in the room.
Light on. I read that. So the light in that room is a diffuse light, preferably not these very bright, too many LED lights. But the contact with you are watching your screen or looking at your laptops is a much higher intensity.
So that's
a different kind of lighting.
Right. So lighting is very important. We're starting with that.
And then we also have other things in the environment, which is the sound, and of course, people who are in this arena now, fortunate enough to have the temperature. So there's an ideal temperature in the room, which is, you know, more compatible with good sleep.
Okay. So that is obviously now we have thermostats and we have air conditioning that you can set to your stuff. All right. There are some more comments, Dr. Manvir. Can you read them or shall I read them for you?
Yeah, so somebody's asking, what is the way to block the thoughts?
So yes.
The brain is actually, it's not an easy thing to just say, okay, I will not think. Right. We need a substitute. So you can never let the brain just go blank. It's very hard. I mean, I think people can achieve it after a lot of practice. So anything that you can do to substitute that thought, that's one part of it. Second, we recommend that please schedule something called as a worry time, plan time, whatever you call it.
Right.
Prior to bedtime. So you take a pen, paper, write everything down. Try not to lie down in bed and start then planning. Oh, today I did this, tomorrow I have to do this. My menu is this, my recipe is this. Even a trivial thing can start off creating a problem.
Okay. I'm going to ask
somebody
you a very...
they can enter their dreams. Yes,
yes.
Sure.
Neeraj Bhatnagar can enter my dreams.
See,
okay.
There's a concept of this dream control and the movies which have done it. Yeah,
of course, in our biotechnologies also, but we'll come to that also. I just want to ask you a very basic question. Somebody asked that the color of the light, does that make a difference, yellow versus white?
Yeah, so normally we don't like these very bright white LED lights. The more softer the light is, much better.
Okay. And there are so many questions. I'm gonna compile them and
so we'll
throw
go
them
with
at
our
you
flow, then we will
one
come
by
to the
one.
Questions.
Yes. All right, guys, do keep sending your questions. I will pull all of them up and there are many questions which are repeated. So hopefully your question will also get an answer, like perfect time to sleep, and somebody asked how much time gap should be in the mobile and sleep, slow walk good after dinner and before sleep.
We used to recommend 2 hours, but now I tell people 1 hour, then we say 45 minutes. So they say escort. So they are saying, and the other terminology I liked was, please escort your devices out of your room and keep them outside somewhere safely. And say, I will see you tomorrow, and now it's good night.
Yeah, so remember your devices are your guests inside your bedroom. Okay.
Yeah,
and when you want to go to sleep, you probably don't want to go to sleep
out
with your beds. They should be escorted to their respective rooms and places. And then you come back to your room. So we will talk about probably a ritual that puts you to sleep as well.
Yeah, also asking about the coronavirus. Should we touch it now or later?
Coronavirus, we will come in a while. Just wanna quickly warm up about this question because these are very basic questions, the first layers. Somebody is asking, is a slow walk good after dinner and before sleep?
So that actually we'll discuss a little bit more about this exercise, which anyway, it's very relevant and even more relevant in today's time. So it will answer that other question also. So there's a lot of research now in some laboratories are only focusing on exercise and sleep. So it has a lot of impact. So before we go into this slow walk or stroll after dinner, I want to talk about the importance of exercise. So exercise has been shown to improve the quality of sleep.
Okay.
So just I'll go a little back actually just for a few seconds and say that there are three dimensions of sleep. One is the quantity, which you talked about in the beginning, that how many hours of sleep do we get?
Right.
Second is the timing that are we sleeping at? I have people sleeping at 5 a.m., waking up at 2 p.m., you know, things like that. That's timing of sleep. Third aspect is the quality of sleep. So in the quality, we mean that when we go through the night, we are not in one phase. We have some light sleep, which people now understand because everybody wears sleep monitors and Fitbits and stuff like that. So we have light sleep, we have some deep sleep, we have REM sleep. Each of these stages of sleep has a very different purpose.
Right.
So exercise is known to improve deep sleep. And when you get a good quota of deep sleep, you feel very refreshed. So this is also linked that sometimes you get up after 6.5, 7 hours feeling very good. probably you've got a good chunk of deep sleep. Sometimes you get up after 8.5 hours feeling really lousy is because right. you didn't get the deep sleep. So that's
and what
how
is the cause behind that? Why that sometimes the time does not really matter because you haven't gone into the depth of the sleep.
It's the quality. So this thing that you have put up, it's called as a overnight hypnogram, meaning the full night has been divided and the horizontal line is the number of hours and these right. bars up and down are your stages.
Right.
So
right.
in the first, so we do need 20 to 25% of our time should be in deep sleep. Deep right. sleep is good for memory. Deep sleep, we'll talk, is good for immunity. Deep sleep is very good for emotional regulation. So right. if you right. don't get that chunk, so people say that, are we in a angry world because our sleep is disturbed? Everybody's very angry.
Yes,
irritable,
yes.
Short
what a wonderful
fuse.
Thought.
So,
yeah, interesting
yeah.
insight.
So there is
yes.
a thought by the sleep right. physicians that right. this world is becoming like this, you know, because we have yeah. disturbed the balance of our body. We don't get good sleep.
Right, and we'll come to that. The work culture that is inducing these bad behaviors into people. But before yeah. that, I wanted to ask you, when you say that obviously sometimes when you even have 10 hours of sleep as well, and we'll come to that also, that you haven't gotten the deep sleep. Why does that happen that people don't get a deep sleep?
So that brings us to this question that, or the answer is that we are spending a larger chunk in the light sleep.
Right.
So why okay. do we spend a larger chunk is because either the brain is very stimulated, you are just going in and out of sleep. This is governed by what you did during the day, which was conducive to sleep, or what you didn't do. So if you've taken five cups of caffeine, last right. cup being before bedtime, sleep is bound to be bad. You watched a horror movie at night, your light sleep quota is much higher. Right. You've had a very sedentary day, your light sleep quota is much higher. So all these are factors which increase your light sleep and don't let you get enough. Then I'm not as of now talking about sleep disorders. You know, so that's a very separate entity. Here right, we're talking right. about yeah. just healthy people.
Lifestyle
we are assuming they don't
issues.
Have a sleep disorder. Yeah, so we're not talking right. about things like snoring. Because snoring right, is right, like a good right. chapter by itself.
Absolutely, absolutely. And I think snoring actually can yeah. induce a lot of trouble in people's, people's lives and relationships
yeah.
and everything
yes.
as
so,
well.
Yeah, yeah. So snoring is a...
Yes, but it's a very interesting thing that you talked about, and I think everybody should focus on this because, you know, what you eat and what you feed your brain and what you do with your body are three critical factors of you, this whether you are going to have a deep sleep or not going to have a deep sleep. Am I correct, Doctor?
Yes. And people keep asking us, what can I do to sleep better?
Right.
But you have to focus on the whole day and pre-bedtime to get the good night.
So the entire day is responsible for your good sleep.
Day, the previous night, how do I right. keep a routine? You know, right. all those things are very important to get that good night. Night cannot happen just that, oh, I just lie down, put the lights off, put my screens off, and I'll get good sleep. Won't happen.
Yeah. So it's a thing that you have to start at the morning for the night. You have to really be conscious about your day for your night.
It is actually a sad state of affairs that something which was taken for granted, which we all grew up as children learning it, now we are learning how to sleep. So, I mean, it's actually sad because I am seeing patients in all age groups where we are trying to teach them how to sleep. I mean, it's sad. And somebody said it's a sad day because we are prescribing sleep as a prescription.
Yeah, yeah.
I mean, that's what it's come to.
Imagine
world has come to that. So it is something that we need to think. And they say there was a campaign recently, Take Back Sleep campaign.
Right. Right. And the people are actually talking about sleep as a scarcity, like something that they demand now, you know, and that's very interesting. Okay. So, you know, there was a question that somebody said that, so coming to the point of what time one should go to sleep and what time one should wake up. And we were talking about those, you know, you were at the beginning talking about two kind of people who are there.
So we are genetic. Now we know because, and people, they won the Nobel Prize a few years ago, three scientists who have actually worked on these, that there are, we are right. genetically different. So there right. are two groups of people. They're called right. the morning larks
right.
and the evening owls.
Okay.
So that means that some people prefer the daylight. They are more active. So this, how do you find out? You find out by yourself that what time of the day do you feel extremely energetic, concentration is good, memory is good, everything is good.
Right. People, so I want you to write down your most energetic part of the day so we can have a pattern going in the comment section.
Yeah. So you yourself will get to know, am I a morning lark or an evening? But unfortunately, so there are some people who are genetically like this, but majority of the people now have pushed it. They have all become owls.
So or maybe the work culture has pushed it and all that. Yes,
work, entertainment, what, both have pushed it. So that's becoming a problem. That's one part. Second is that it will interfere with your day. Unfortunately. So future is going to come that your jobs, you may be able to select that I'm a morning lark, I will do this shift, and I'm an evening person, I will do. But as of now, we do have fixed hours. So it's not very easy.
And, you know, so that brings me to a very interesting concept of work culture as well, that obviously morning larks probably will fit into the day working culture.
Much better.
But what about what about evening owls? I mean, they have to also make money, right?
Yeah, so they have to work a little harder on their routine.
Okay.
And actually, science has also shown that their health is more compromised. So they need to take care of that. So they did not allow the pattern, suppose it's 11 or 12 or 1, but they should not allow it to reach 4 or 5.
Right.
Yeah, then it will become really bad.
But I would consider evening owls, maybe I'll put them somewhere between, let's say, 1 a.m. to 3 a.m., right?
I've seen people at 5 a.m.
Of course. I know somebody, there's one person in comment section, he tells me that he wakes up, he sleeps at 5 a.m. or 6 a.m. and wakes up at 2 p.m.
Yeah.
So the question was that, so obviously, first question was that, is it healthy? And I think the answer you have given is that because if you are an evening owl, obviously this is your natural cycle.
Yeah, but you need to work on yourself.
But you need to work on yourself to fit into the world.
Fit into the world. Yes.
Okay. And that's why you need to work extra or find a job which probably requires to fit into your sleep pattern, and that can work better. Is that correct?
Yeah. If you're lucky enough. Yeah, I have some people like that also.
Right. Yeah. Or maybe if you are like a, I don't know, an artist, painter, filmmaker, or somehow
and if you,
DJ
some people
or
have,
something. You know?
Yeah.
Go ahead.
No, that's that part. Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. So that point is there, obviously. So if so, what happens when evening owls or morning larks try to change their pattern? What are the symptoms that is affecting them? You know.
So that brings us to this important concern that what happens when we don't get our good quota of sleep. So I think people should write that. Anybody, what have people experienced when you feel that you have not got the amount of sleep that you need? So we do know there could be physical things, some things like headaches, body aches, exhaustion. There can be mood related things. There could be irritability. There can be cognitive things, meaning that concentration is not good. I can't focus on my work. You know, so these are the kind of things people will start feeling if they don't get, suppose somebody sleeps at 2, 3 a.m.
Right.
But has to go for work, say, by 10. So has to get up by about 7 or 8. So he's getting only 4 or 5. So somebody, this is what they are writing. So they will feel exhausted. So this could be a physical change. It could be an emotional change. Or it could be just a mixture of everything together.
All right. So, guys, whenever you are experiencing these symptoms, which means the first thing you must check is that whether you got a good sleep or what time did you sleep last night, and that could be you go into any other analysis about yourself or googling.
So we can do a self-analysis. There is something called as a sleep diary, which is available on my website, but it's in American. So people can fill it themselves and get an idea of what's happening.
Right. And would you like to tell the name of your website, Dr. Manvi, please? For them.
So my site is neurologysleepcenter.com.
Okay. NeurologySleepCenter.com, guys, please go there and check out for the sleep diary. Which
and simple questions like this have also, what the questions are coming up are also in the book called The Sleep Solution.
Yeah, I'm going to talk about that also at some point. Yes, in the show. So this is a wonderful, wonderful conversation tonight. And I think it's just right for these times that we are living in as well, but not even this. Limited to this few months that we are stuck into, but a lot of your life, which is before and after this, will give you a lot of insight about it. People are very curious about sleep because it is a very important part of our life. And I want to come to the basic question, Dr. Manvi, is that what is sleep and why do we have it?
So sleep, partly we touched upon that. Firstly, it's been in all organisms, all mammals, all reptiles, it's very interesting if you go through all that. So we human beings are not unique to sleep, but I'm not going into that. I mean, some like a dolphin sleeps when they are erect, part of their brain sleeps, part doesn't sleep. It's very interesting, all that. Birds fly many miles, they don't sleep, and or part of their brain sleeps and the other don't sleep. Human beings, the brain is, so for many years, this was thought that this is a passive process.
Right.
But now with the technology, we know sleep is a very active process. So there are areas of the brain which are kind of lighting up, as we call them, as during the night.
Right.
And different areas come up or show increased activity at different times of the night.
Right, right.
And we talked a little bit about the stages. So there are these stages which happen. Each stage has a regulation effect. Some people asked about the effect on the appetite, effect on the metabolism, effect on the weight. So during sleep, there are these hormones which are released, which control the mood, the appetite and behavior. So if the sleep is not good, there is one hormone which tells you how much to eat and what to eat. They're two separate ones. These get a little imbalanced. So you love junk food.
Very interesting.
You get cravings for carbohydrate rich foods. So people who go up to the fridge at night, and the longer they stay awake, they will eat all kinds of junk and the weight will go up. And the second hormone, which tells you, okay, stop. That hormone is not working adequately. So they will eat a lot more and they will eat all the wrong things. So we say the choices that you make for eating are deranged, which your sleep is not good.
Right. Very interesting, because this is a very interesting discovery that if your sleep is not good, there are very strong chances that you will gain weight. And not
you
because directly the effect of lack of sleeping, but the behavior that sleep will change in you. You will have craving
Somebody's
for
asking
more food.
The names. The names are called ghrelin and leptin. You can read more about them later. The two
ghrelin
hormones
and
will tell
leptin,
you.
Yes.
Leptin, yeah. So how much to eat and what to eat. So they get into an imbalance.
Okay, so which means that if you are having a good sleep, you probably will have a healthy eating habit.
Yeah, exactly. So for children, we are very concerned now. You know, we are seeing a lot of children obesity. Is because, not all, but one factor could be because of their sleep is not adequate, so they make wrong choices.
Okay, very interesting. And especially now, combining with your first step that you were talking about, the screen time, and children are obviously having more screen time now. And obviously, a lot of parents don't know this, but they give mobile phone or iPads to their kids before they go to sleep to so avoid the engagement of putting them to sleep. Yes, yes. And that's very interesting. And that probably makes them more obese.
Yes.
And so that's a very interesting thing. All the parents there must pay attention to this, that it is extremely critical and dangerous that you keep your children away from screen for at least 1 or 2 hours before they go to sleep. Am I correct, Dr. Bhatia?
Yeah, there are also rules and guidelines as to how much screen time is allowed for each age.
Right. Okay. So somebody asked in the comment section that how much sleep time is good for 60 plus.
So we talked about something called as a sleep need. The second aspect of sleep need is definitely it depends upon the age. People who have seen small children, if they're your relatives or friends, you do know that the baby about a year or so will need about 13 hours of sleep.
Right.
Toddlers start getting about 10, 11. Teenagers actually is the biggest thing. They need 9 right. hours. So no teenager world over gets 9 hours. So they are what is called as a continuous state of sleep deprivation. Adults generally from, let's say, whatever 30s to 60s or whatever, will need about range of 7 to 8.5.
Okay.
The sleep then changes beyond 75 or so.
Okay.
That the deep sleep quota becomes less.
Okay.
So then people will continuously say that I am not sleeping well. So for that population, we have to teach them or make them understand that yes, sleep is not going to be that good, but please do not take a sleeping pill. I mean, that's a very great point that I want to emphasize whenever I give a talk, that please, if you think your sleep is not good, you follow the principles of sleep hygiene, do whatever, meet a specialist.
Therapy
Do not self-medicate for sleeping pills.
Would you like to shed some more light on it, that what happens exactly if you take sleep pills or without
sleeping pills, what do they really do? Sleeping pill, in a simple word, is just dampening your brain.
Right.
We just talked about it briefly, that the brain is very alert at night. It's forming memories. There's a very interesting concept which I wouldn't want the audience to go back with. There is, like, now recently we've discovered that the brain, there's like a vacuum cleaning going on at night.
Right.
All the toxins are being removed. All the substances which are harmful for you are being removed in that good sleep. Mm. So imagine, they say, you imagine like a garden. It's full of weeds. So the weeds have to be taken out for the grass to grow.
Beautiful.
So new memories to form, you need to clear. So if the sleep is not good, you cannot form new memories and you cannot store memories.
Mm.
So what does sleeping pills do? Sleeping pills just put a lid on all this.
Right. So they will affect
your memory. Mm. More toxic. And you get something called as habituation. Today you will take a dose of like whatever. I don't want to name the tablets, like say one. Tomorrow you will need two. In 6 months, you will need three. So I have people coming to me, 10 years sleep problems, 20 years sleep problem. They've tried about 30 medicines. It's very sad.
Cocktail.
So don't reach that stage. Take help, sort it out before. I would say that the youngsters I find are very good now. I'm seeing them at a much faster pace. Maybe it's some awareness. You know, they have 6 months problem, 3 month problem. They're calling in for help.
Which is
really good. Yes. I mean, I think.
Yes, exactly. And we see that trend a lot at Cobalt Blue Foundation. A lot of people are there who are very open about mental issues and including sleep issues. And they're going, it's not a taboo anymore. It's not ignorance anymore.
It's not. So once you confront it, you tackle it, it'll be gone. So in fact, there is a very strong link now between sleep, poor sleep, and anxiety and depression.
Right. And what is that link? Would you like to elaborate on that?
It's what we now, the research has shown that it is what is called as bi-directional. Meaning that if your sleep is not good, you are at a greater risk to develop anxiety and depression. And we also know that people with anxiety and depression, their symptom might be just poor sleep. So that, brings us to this COVID situation.
Yes. And
read some research this morning because I said, let me see what is the latest. So they said that there was a survey, because America does surveys very fast the moment something like this happens.
Yeah,
76% of Americans are saying that their sleep is not good during this time in the last 2-3 weeks. 30-40% increase in the prescriptions of sleeping pills and anti-anxiety medications.
That's a huge number.
It's a huge, it's very frightening. Yeah. So it's having a big impact. So there was a BBC serial also which said that the people with anxiety are getting worse. And people who had no anxiety are also getting anxiety.
And
so it's, you know,
at least I am like, you know, I like some of these communities and countries that they are, they have these numbers because they do check people and there is a lot of awareness about it. So people come out and self-declare as well. In our country, first of all, there is no awareness. A lot of people don't even know that how sleep and anxiety is connected. उनको लगता है कि चिंता जो है वो बहुत सारी चीजों के लिए है और स्लीप तो वो कभी सोचते ही नहीं है पहला दूसरा है कि जो हमारे सिस्टम्स हैं जो भी जिस तरह के हैं उसमें ये नंबर्स नहीं है वी डोंट हैव पीपल
सो दिस लार्ज सर्वेस सम पीपल डू इट बट इट्स हार्ड यू नो देयर बिकॉज़ यू कैन सेंड अ क्वेश्चनेयर्स आउट सो यू कैन गेट सम आईडिया बट आई डिड I mean, I think I knew that there would be a big impact, but there has been a tremendous impact on this, on people, on the mental health.
Yeah. So, what is the situation of India? So, coming to now, the COVID-19 situation, right? I mean, this was declared in January. The whole thing began, and we are now absolutely immersed in this. You know, everybody is talking about it. WhatsApp is filled with this. News is filled with this. You just can't talk about anything else right now, and it is obviously affecting people as well. And it has come to our show also. You know, we are talking about COVID-19 as well. Is there what is the situation in India? I mean, specifically in your subject area, that sleeping and anxiety.
So I've started doing online consultations because the clinic is closed and I'm not seeing patients face to face. With poor sleep. You know, I saw a child, I mean, the mother called me up for the child. The child's sleep has become very bad. So I will tell you why. I saw a 20 years old, I mean, on the phone consultation, I've seen a 45 and I've seen a 60 years old lady.
Right.
So what's happening is that we are spending, now screen time is one thing, but screen time, just listening to news is like we said in the beginning, it's like a double whammy.
Right.
You know, content. You are constantly filled with negativity.
Right.
And we have a system in our body, which is called as this drive system, which is just going into a hyper mode.
Right.
And that system, once it gets activated, like steroids are pumping in our body, sleep.
It's like the fight and flight mode.
Yes, the flight and fight system. So some amount of fight and flight is good, but imagine if you're living in that. So thus,
constantly.
The thing is that, and then people are not following any routine. You know, the time in bed, we call it, is become much longer. So you're lying down. You are also just on screen in the bed. So there's no timing. The body is not in a clock. So we need to set the body clock. That is number one. Fix timings for food, exercise, etc. And decrease the news time. So fix a time that, okay, I will listen to it in the morning. I listen to it in the evening. During the day, please stay away from all this. And the children are picking up on it because the parents or the elders are not realizing that we are continuously talking about it. So the kids are getting the impact also.
Yeah. They are thinking that if the adults are worried, then there must be something.
Yeah. And then they also then imbibe it or they kind of absorb all this negativity.
I know some of my friends who have kids as young as 4 years old or 6 years old, and those kids are talking about and are asking their parents questions about corona and all this. And it's like how that information went to them in their head, you know.
Because everybody's talking, but I think we need to occupy them, distract them, do lots of other things. Like this is what's I was listening to some webinar today, and the professor quoted a very nice line, and he said, you know, by Charles Dickens, the book, and he said, there are good times and there are bad times. So he said, who are the good times for? The current good times are for the nature, for the birds, So it's a bad time for the humans, but it's a good time for many things. So also
there's always a bad side
and a good side. So reinvent yourself, do some hobbies, focus on something which you've not done. You people say, I have no time. So now you have the time, but stay away from the news. Don't watch the news too much.
Yes. And I think whatever has been said and has to be said about it has been said. Now it's only numbers coming, and numbers is not important for you at all. You know,
it's important for us to be careful, to take some tips and to follow some rules. I would say that.
Right.
I mean, definitely.
Right. Exactly.
You know, we can't forget that. But we can't.
But there is somebody said that do not count, stop counting numbers of people getting infected or number of people dying, because that is
just
not relevant.
Take your precautions.
Take your precautions about it, and that's about it. But somebody was asking, coming to this part of anxiety-related sleep things and all that. You have given some very, very valuable tips to avoid news, set some routine for yourself. And obviously, in the first part of the show, we talked about how to set a healthy routine of sleeping, avoid screen time. And then you talked about three kind of sleep, right? Would you like to summarize that three part once again for people who have joined later?
For the dimensions of sleep?
Yes.
The stages or dimensions? Dimensions.
So dimensions, sleep, yes.
Dimensions. So the sleep, when we talk about sleep, the three dimensions are the quantity of sleep, which mostly people are able to understand, the number of hours you get.
Right.
Second is the timing of sleep.
Right.
What time do you sleep and what time you wake up? So some people have asked, what is an ideal time? So, you know, again, this is again very individual. But let's say, you know, little before midnight. I mean, like, I can't tell people to sleep at 8, 9 p.m. But again, children, it's different. We're talking about adults. And then you calculate that you need 7 or 8 hours, and that's your wake up time. So do not spend extra time in bed when you're not sleeping. That's another rule.
Okay.
And the third as part is the quality of sleep. So the quality of sleep means that I get my good chunk of deep sleep, which helps me to clear out the brain, clean the brain up, secrete all the hormones, and store the memories. And then we have a REM sleep. So the REM sleep was discovered just because a lot of eye movements which happen. It's called as a rapid eye movement sleep.
Right.
Is very good for emotional regulation.
Okay.
So it forms the link between the emotion and a memory. So everybody can think about some happy time they had or a sad time they had. Hopefully we'll be out of this, so we won't, you know, but the human brain has a capacity to forget also. There is always an emotion linked with the memory. So these two go and get kind of reinforced in the REM sleep.
Right.
Then over a period of time, the emotion part goes away. So that's very important for this, the emotional regulation.
Right.
So but those are the three dimensions, the quantity, the quality, and the timing. So when we need to get good chunk, we should look at all these.
Wonderful. So quantity, quality, and the timing are QQT. You can note down as your and put it in your bedroom, and you will know exactly what Dr. Manvi is talking about here, which is very important not only for your physical health, also to reduce weight, but also your emotional health and your hormonal balance as well,
and mental health.
And mental health as well, which is more important obviously than your physical health. A lot of people want to know something about dreams and sleep. Is dreaming and
so
sleeping, how are they connected?
There's no talk which goes without these dreams. So I keep telling them that I'm a neurologist. So dreams are the realm of mostly psychologists. My daughter is a psychologist. Right. I keep telling her that whenever I do a show, you please do one more show for the dream part.
We should do something with her.
You should do. So dreams, she's, I mean, good at. All that we know from the scientific part is what I told you, that dreams happen in a lot of stages. It was earlier thought that they are only in the REM sleep. The difference being REM sleep, you remember, other parts dream, sometimes you don't remember. That's one. Secondly, everybody dreams. Some people say, no, I don't dream. Somebody says, I dream too much. But everybody dreams. It depends upon your recall.
Right.
And third is that there is some kind of relationship with the day. So sometimes I haven't done that recently, but I get very vivid dreams. So I run them through my daughter at times, and she's able to sometimes fraction it out and tell me, as to why they are happening.
That would be lovely. I think we should do a show with her on this interpretation of dreams.
Yeah, of dreams.
Yes,
and people can write their dreams and send it to her, and she won't do it because she says, I have to know the person, I have to know. You know, psychologists are not very easy to get to.
Yes, of course. But she can provide some sort of insight into why.
Yeah, but we do know that there are entities like nightmares, which are horrible dreams.
Right.
And then nightmares can affect your quality of sleep. So, you need to...